Thank you. Could I ask those members who are leaving the chamber to please do so quickly and quietly, as we are now going on to the final item of business. And the final item of business is the members' business debate on motion 12066 in the name of Faisal Chowdhury on Brain Tumour Awareness Month. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak button. And I call on Faisal Chowdhury to open the debate. Around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It is an honour to open my members' business. I would like to begin by thanking all those who signed the motion and my colleagues who have chosen to speak at this debate on such an important issue. I would also like to thank Thomas from the charity Brain Tumour Research, who is attending this debate today. And I welcome Nadia, who has campaigned to raise awareness of brain tumour since her son Raihan sadly passed away after being diagnosed with a brain tumour in 2017. We should also note that today is Purple Day, where members have been raising awareness of epilepsy. 2 in 3 people diagnosed with brain tumour will be experiencing epilepsy or seizures, and the most common symptoms in adult of brain tumour is epilepsy. I was happy to see so many members partake in We Are a Hat Day and attended the reception with brain tumour research sponsored by Beatrice Wishart. Charities like Brain Tumour Research do amazing work in funding cutting-edge research through their centres of excellence and offering support to those living with brain tumour. But we must do more to support their work. Outcomes for those living with brain tumours remain far worse than other cancers. According to Cancer Research, over 450 people die each year in Scotland from brain tumours, killing more men under 70 than prostate cancer, and more women under 35 than breast cancer. Brain tumour research found that the 5-year survival rate for a person diagnosed with a brain tumour is just 12.9%, compared with over 70% for breast cancer. Despite these alarming figures, brain tumours are not being treated as a priority. Just 1% of UK spending on cancer research has been allocated to brain tumour since record began in 2002. Patients and their families are being left down by this lack of funding. More investment in research can lead to more clinical trials, new knowledge, and improved options and outcomes for patients. We must take serious action so that clinical research and treatment of brain tumours is given the attention it deserves. Brain tumours act differently to other types of cancer and should be treated as such. Because of the differences in the way they develop when compared to other cancers, they are often missed by NHS cancer programme or GPs. This means patients are often left in the dark or finding they have a tumour when they are admitted to A&D. This was the case for Nadia. She took her son, Raihan, to 4 different GPs after he was suffering with consistent symptoms. It took her taking him to A&D, where he had an MRI, for him to finally be diagnosed with brain tumour. Patron of brain tumour research, Theo Burrell, was also misdiagnosed for 6 months, suffering extreme migraines before a scan at A&D revealed she had a tumour in her brain. Had the tumour not been found, she would only have had 3 months to live. This experience is far too common amongst those suffering with brain tumours. The Brain Tumour Charity found 41% of the people suffering from a brain tumour had to visit their GP 3 or more times before being diagnosed. Getting diagnosed earlier can help with uncertainty that many face by allowing patients to access emotional support and better manage their symptoms. Quick diagnosis also gives patients the opportunity to take part in the clinical trials, which have the lowest recruitment levels of any cancer, according to the Institute of Cancer Research. The Scottish Government Cancer Strategy published last year, rightly focusing on cancers which have poorer survival rates, such as brain tumours. But to be successful, funding must be ring-fenced to allow for discovery research of innovative treatment. More needs to be done to develop specialist knowledge and clinical training amongst the medical practitioners. A new diagnostic pathway should also be developed, which clinical and laboratory leaders, so no one is left waiting for diagnosis. Brain tumours have been left ignored for too long. They should no longer be considered too difficult to plan for. It is time to act. A new strategy must be created which recognises the differences between brain tumour and other cancers and delivers for patients. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chowdhury. I now call Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Jackson Carlow. Mr. Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I congratulate my colleague Faisal Chowdhury for securing debating time on this crucial issue. Each year, approximately 1,000 people in Scotland are diagnosed with brain cancer or cancer of the central nervous system. And sadly, as Faisal pointed out, less than 13% survive beyond 5 years from their initial diagnosis. Despite these sobering statistics, awareness of this disease remains astonishingly low. Evidence from brain tumour research suggests that fewer than 10% of people in the UK are aware that brain tumours claim more lives among children and adults under the age of 40 than any other form of cancer. Clearly, the need to raise awareness about brain cancer has never been more urgent. Brain tumours can manifest a variety of symptoms depending on the location and growth rate. Common indicators include persistent headaches, changes to reasoning and cognitive abilities, nausea, vomiting and seizures. Given that these vague symptoms are common among various diseases and illnesses, it's essential that people promptly visit their GP if they're concerned about their brain health. However, as we've already heard, GPs also need better training in order to diagnose brain tumours, particularly at an early stage. Dr. Paul Brennan, Honorary Consultant Neurosurgeon at the University of Edinburgh, emphasised that early diagnosis is key to the effectiveness of brain cancer treatment and reducing the occurrence and impact of side effects. The Rapid Cancer Diagnostic Services currently operates across 5 health board areas, including North Ayrshire and Arran, which serves my own constituency. And these services facilitate the prompt referral of patients exhibiting non-specific cancer symptoms, ensuring they receive the results within 21 days. Previously, patients who didn't meet the Scottish referral guidelines for suspected cancer, or those with non-specific suspicious symptoms, had to undergo a battery of tests overseen by primary care. An evaluation report on the service conducted by the University of Strathclyde and the Centre for Sustainable Delivery reveals that over the 2-year evaluation period, these services attended 2,489 patients, with more than 96% rating the service positively. Nevertheless, despite significant advancement in early diagnosis, Faisal Chowdhury's message could not be clearer. Brain cancer remains a cancer of unmet need. According to the Brain Cancer Research Group, this can only be rectified by filling gaps in our knowledge about how brain cancer works. The publication of the Scottish Government's Cancer Strategy, with its emphasis on research and innovation, has been warmly received by both the medical community and politicians. The strategy delineates plans for health professionals to dedicate research time, ensure sufficient laboratory support, and foster collaboration across academia, industry, and the third sector. Additionally, there's a pledge to enhance access to research and clinical trials for minority ethnic groups and those currently underrepresented in such trials. Research will be concentrated on cancer types with the highest burden and poorest outcomes, including less survivable cancers such as those affecting the liver, pancreas and brain. Moreover, pioneering research is underway within our Scottish universities. The Brain Cancer Centre Excellence, a collaborative effort between the University of Edinburgh and University College London, is dedicated to research in the biology of brain cancer to advance treatment strategies. Employing state-of-the-art, data-driven innovation and advanced imaging techniques, researchers are delving into the intricacies of patient-derived glioma cells to uncover new avenues for drug discovery. Additionally, Professor Stephen Tait of the University of Glasgow is spearheading efforts to unravel the mechanisms underlying tumour formation. His research focuses on elucidating how cancer cells evade programmed cell death, offering promising insights that could lead to the development of more effective therapeutic interventions. Presiding Officer, Scotland has taken positive steps in addressing the challenges posed by brain cancer with concerted efforts at various levels, such as advancing research and improving diagnostic and treatment services. It's evident that brain tumour researchers' work is invaluable. The life-saving research, ongoing campaigning and innovative research projects are essential to improving patient well-being, increase awareness of symptoms and improve our understanding of the disease. I'm delighted that their Demand for Change petition has reached 81,000 signatures and hope that this will change attitudes towards the disease and highlight the importance of funding to support patients and increase research. Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Gibson. I now call Jackson Carlaw to be followed by Jackie Bailey. Mr. Carlaw.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I congratulate Faisal Chowdhury on his motion this evening. I have great pleasure of serving with Faisal Chowdhury in the Public Petitions Committee, and I know how committed he is to this issue, and he focused on individuals, and I probably will, in my own remarks, return to that too. Presiding Officer, every 33 minutes, an individual in the UK is informed that they are living with a brain tumour. And around 45 people are therefore diagnosed every day, and 60% of them with a high-grade brain tumour will not survive the course of a year. Earlier this year, along with Paul Sweeney, I hosted an event for the less survivable cancers. The Minister was present at that. One of these is brain tumours, along with lung, liver, esophagus, pancreas and stomach. It's a great opportunity tonight to be able to discuss the issues that arise from it. The key asks of the Less Survivable Cancers group that was hosted by the Brain Tumour Charity are to collect and assess both clinical data and patient-reported outcome measurements, to establish more medical oncologist positions in the UK, a major increase in the amount and frequency of tissue samples, to better understand the diagnostic pathway for brain tumours in adults, to promote and encourage greater joint working between clinicians and industry leaders, and to investigate investigations to take place over the lengthy time periods to collect information on the long-term and late effects of brain tumour. And can I also pay tribute to Beatrice Wishart, who's brought a tremendous amount of focus to this issue during the last month, and who I know intends to set up a cross-party group on brain tumours, and if it will assist her, then I would be happy to lend that group my support. But I would like to focus, as Faisal Chowdhury did, on individuals and on a constituent of mine, Fraser McAllister. Fraser was only 16 at the time of his diagnosis. And I have to say it was a late diagnosis, and that is the subject of an investigation. But I want to focus tonight on the courage that Fraser showed at the age of 16, in the strength and resilience with which he then tackled the condition that he had. Just a week ago, my constituent Henry Wooga died, and we made reference to it in this chamber. And Henry used to say to everybody whenever confronted with a problem, just get on with it. Well, if anybody just got on with it, it was Fraser, who at the age of 16 decided he wasn't going to put his life on hold and did everything that he could. But more importantly, he decided he would document his brain tumour story, and his dignity and courage and bravery in the face of the adversity that with which he was faced is truly inspiring. In his account, he wrote, "Just 4 days after admission, I had surgery to have a drain put into my head. 5 days after that, I had an operation to remove the tumour. I was in theatre for nearly 11 hours because of complications. The following day, I was back in theatre to have a tracheostomy fitted. I had a couple of weeks after the main operation, but I never gave up, even though I couldn't move my body." And can I say to the Minister, that Fraser reached out, and he reached out to her parliamentary colleague Amy Callaghan, who herself had suffered from a brain tumour, who responded to Fraser and gave him the courage and advice that I think helped him at that time. So just as we saw in the events over the weekend of others, those who are suffering, reaching out can have a profound impact on those that are suffering. But I'm sorry to say Fraser passed away in July 2022 at the age of 18. His courage came from his mother, who is in the gallery tonight, Caroline, with her husband. And she is just as courageous as he is, and has made sure that Fraser's memory and fight continues. He produced a poster that I hope when I post it tonight, other members might take the trouble to repost. It was his symptoms as a young man facing this condition. What did he feel? Dizziness, not constantly, whilst bathing in hot water, looking vertically upwards to the sky, or at an unusual time for you, he said, eye movement, double vision, a headache not all the time, if they do not massively reduce or go away with painkillers, it happens often, nauseous or sickness, feeling sick or having stomach pain for any length of time, being sick with bile only, and in the morning. Those were his symptoms. They're the symptoms of a teenager that he wanted to ensure others facing the condition that he did would have a chance of surviving with the earliest possible diagnosis. That's the sort of example, I think, that can inspire us all. Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Carlow. I now call Jackie Bailey to be followed by Beatrice Wishart. Ms. Bailey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Let me begin with three thanks. Firstly, to my colleague Faisal Chowdhury for securing this important debate to mark Brain Tumour Awareness Month, to Beatrice Wishart for her event last week where we all wore hats, and to her as well for setting up the cross-party group, to which I've already agreed to be part of, and finally to Jackson Carlaw for his most excellent and considered speech. Now, I wasn't aware that brain tumours kill more children than leukaemia. Faisal Chowdhury rightly pointed out that they kill more women under 35 than breast cancer, and they kill more men under 70 than prostate cancer does. Yet just 12.9% of those diagnosed with a brain tumour survive beyond 5 years, compared with an average of 54% across all other cancers. And life expectancy is reduced on average by 27 years, the highest of any cancer. Now, despite this, treatment options have seen little advance for decades. Yet we do have real strengths with Scotland's research and life sciences sector, so we can improve on this. We know that Scotland's NHS is in crisis, and this crisis extends to cancer services. Today's statistics do not make for happy reading. They reveal a failure to meet the 31 and 62-day cancer targets, whilst waiting times are simply getting worse. But there are steps that the Scottish Government can and should take to make this better. The Brain Tumour Charity and Brain Tumour Research have each outlined comprehensive steps that will go some way to addressing barriers to brain tumour treatment. By developing a national strategy, we can address those barriers across the whole brain tumour pathway, including diagnosis, care, treatment and research. Brain tumours should be treated as a clinical and strategic priority by the Scottish Government, with funding to support discovery science and improved access to tissue and imaging methods. Now, I warmly welcome the news that Brain Tumour Research is in the early stages of fundraising to open a Scottish Brain Tumour Research Centre of Excellence. And they're doing that in partnership with the Beats and Cancer Charity. But we need to ensure that there is a greater capacity through investment in both people and infrastructure if brain tumour research is to reach its full potential. It's not enough for us to come to the Chamber and offer warm words of support. The Government must outline exactly how it will support the research community to improve patient outcomes in the long term. But of course, research is only one piece of the puzzle, and more must be done to support patients when they've been diagnosed with a brain tumour. Respondents to the Brain Tumour Charity's Improving Brain Tumour Care survey reported that 85% felt that they had unmet needs and 59% felt they needed more help understanding their condition. Access to a clinical nurse specialist is crucial for people with brain tumours, and the Scottish Government reflected this in last year's Cancer Action Plan. And that was most welcome, because you stated that everybody diagnosed with cancer should have access to a key support worker. But the target to achieve this, which was in the recent draft quality performance indicator for brain and central nervous system cancers, has simply been removed. It's vanished, Minister. And therefore I say to you, the indicator should be restored urgently. Evidence should be gathered on whether brain tumour patients are getting the access they need, because after all, that was what was promised in the strategy. Once diagnosed, people should also have access to a holistic needs assessment and care plan, again outlined in the Scottish Cancer Strategy, and the government should provide an update on whether this is happening across the board. The reality is that brain tumour survival remains far too low. We need more than warm words to actually deliver any real hope. And it's time for the Scottish Government to get round the table, deliver the funding needed to address both brain tumour research and treatment in Scotland, not just during the Awareness Month, but all year round. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Bailey. I now call Beatrice Wishart to be followed by Alexander Stewart. Ms Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I too thank and congratulate Faisal Chowdhury for bringing this important debate about brain tumours to the Chamber this evening. And can I also thank all colleagues who took part in the Wear a Hat Day in the photo call that I hosted with brain tumour research earlier this month, and to those who came along to the event afterwards. Raising awareness is so important. As Faisal Chowdhury's motion highlights, 1 in 3 people know someone affected, but diagnosis can be difficult. Last year, Emma Harper brought a similar debate to the Chamber, and her motion referenced that brain tumour symptoms, quote, mimic other equally serious conditions. This can delay diagnosis and treatments. Many, many years ago, a friend of mine talked to me about headaches she was experiencing. I've worn glasses all my life, so I have regular checkups at the opticians, and I mentioned to her that she might want to get her eyes tested. That she did so led to the discovery, via her optician, that she had a brain tumour. It was pure luck that conversation happened and the diagnosis made, and she as well. It highlights, though, how important regular everyday health checks are. No one wants an unexpected surprise from a checkup, but it can save lives. We know that every year in Scotland, around 1,000 people are diagnosed with brain tumours, and sadly, around 400 people die from them. Which leads me to concerns about how much longer such a diagnosis might take today, as the NHS's recovery from COVID continues, with pressure on primary care and a shortage of GPs. Brain Tumour Research's manifesto, It's Time to Do Things Differently, calls for a declaration that brain tumours are a clinical priority and to approach improving options and outcomes for brain tumour patients with appropriate urgency. It calls for a doubling of the annual research spend across adult and paediatric brain tumours for 2020-21, totalling £35 million per year by 2028. The development of a roadmap for full deployment of the £40 million research funds made available in 2018. The implementation of a monitoring system for this spend, with decision-making authority to be overseen by a new brain tumour research institute made up of clinicians, researchers and charities, specifically targeting with funding research that will drive both discovery and research so that we can find cures, and increased participation of adult and paediatric brain tumour patients in clinical trials. The Brain Tumour Research Centre of Excellence at the University of Plymouth is making progress in diagnosing meningiomas through a non-invasive blood test. That would spare future patients having to undergo invasive surgery, which is what happened to one of my daughters. Such research and clinical trials could be undertaken in Scotland to improve early diagnosis and find treatments for patients. I've spoken before about plans to have a cross-party group on brain tumours, and I'm pleased to say that I've garnered support from across the chamber, and subject to the necessary formalities, I am hopeful the group will be underway soon. I encourage colleagues to join us, and I thank you to Jackson Carlaw this evening for your support, and to Jackie Bailey, who has also agreed to join us, as Finlay Carson and others have done. Colin Smith, I see here. The group should raise awareness of the issues facing the brain tumour community in order to improve research, diagnosis, information, support, treatment and care outcomes. Historically, there's been underfunding of research into brain tumours, with just 1% of the national spend on cancer research having been allocated to them. So let's work together to support the work of charities and other organisations such as Brain Tumour Research and close the care gap. As the motion in today's debate states, unlike in many other cancers, brain tumour survival statistics have changed little in over a generation. Presiding Officer, we need to change that.
Thank you, Ms. Wishart. I now call Alexander Stewart to be followed by Colin Smith. Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased to be speaking in today's debate, and I congratulate my fellow member, Faisal Chowdhury, for bringing it to the Chamber. At this early stage of my contribution, I'd like to commend the excellent work of organisations such as the Brain Tumour Charity and Brain Tumour Research for the work that they do. In addition, I'd also like to pay tribute to the phenomenal courage and resilience of many of the patients and their families, for whom we regularly meet here in the Parliament, and I think that's good to have that exchange. As the motion for today's debate says, Brain Tumour Awareness Month is March, and it's dedicated to raising awareness of what is seen as an important brain tumour research and shining a light on the patients and the population across Scotland. This is not merely vitally important, Presiding Officer, but I consider it essential, especially as we've heard today from some of the diagnosis and the information that we've already received about the treatment of brain tumours. Early in the previous session, I became aware of a tragic case from a constituent in Dunfermline, Mark Richardson, who had an awful situation. Back in 2017, during an opening of my debate, I had here on the members' debate on members when we talked about that, we heard and I spoke about the Mark, who had been a popular manager with Diageo and had a stepson and two toddlers, and he was becoming aware of the situations. And once again, diagnosis was the problem. He was having blackouts, he was having eye problems, and none of it was being followed up to see that that could have been. And tragically, Mark died in July of 2016 at the age of 32. Now, Mark already had, as I said, had been going to and been giving some treatment. He had neck pain, he had experienced an eye bleed, and even going to the optician, nobody found that he had a cancerous brain tumour the size of a golf ball. So, Deputy Presiding Officer, it's now 7 years since I made that debate and was part of that debate. And I said at the time that brain tumours are currently a cancer of unmet need. And here we are today, 7 years later, saying exactly the same thing, calling on the Scottish Government and calling on the NHS to really focus on ensuring that diagnosis is treated. The investment that we need in research to improve diagnosis, to find more effective and less harmful treatments, and ultimately to find a cure. I have been and wholeheartedly ensured that in recent years that we decide to do that. And decades on, we're still struggling to find that, Deputy Presiding Officer. Mark's story made such an impact on me that I became much more involved in the organisation and held roundtable meetings and met with consultants and had patients here, and MSPs had to come into drop-in events. And I was extremely humbled that the Brain Tumour Charity nominated myself back in 2019 as one of the influences of the year within that charity. And I commend and congratulate Beatrice what she's trying to achieve. And I look forward to supporting you, Beatrice, as you go forward with the cross-party group as well. So I urge the Scottish Government and the Brain Tumour Charities and health professionals to continue to work together to ensure that individuals are supported and protected through their journey. The Scottish Government must ensure that all brain tumour patients have access to the clinical nurse specialist or a key worker who carries out assessments on the patient's histolytic requirements following their diagnosis. Signposts must be in place for the patient to access local support. Patients with brain tumour should have the option of discussing palliative care with consultants at the point of their diagnosis. So in conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, I reiterate my pledge to all that I can do in the position I have here within the Parliament to work with and fight for the corner and fight for the individuals and maintain awareness, because it's the maintaining of that awareness and ensuring that we keep that in the profile that gives us all the hope and gives many of these individuals hope for the future. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Stewart. I call Colin Smith to be followed by Finlay Carson. Mr Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to my colleague Faisal Childrey for lodging his motion, which I think, as we've heard this evening, has given a voice in Parliament to so many affected by brain tumours. We can get a man on the moon, but we can't cure brain tumours. It's so frustrating, and funding is so thin on the ground. These are words from Theo Burrell, a patron of brain tumour research. Some of you will know Theo as a presenter on the BBC Antiques Roadshow. Many will certainly know Theo's mother-in-law, my good friend Elaine Murray, the former member of the Scottish Parliament for Dumfriesshire. Theo was diagnosed with a brain tumour nearly 2 years ago. She was just 35 at the time and mum to one-year-old Jonah. 2 weeks ago, many of us were privileged to hear from Theo when she shared her story at the brain tumour research reception in Parliament hosted by Beatrice Wishart. Anyone who listened to Beatrice and Theo share the stories of the impact on their families will have been touched. The shock to Theo and her husband Alex when she received her diagnosis, her calm frankness when she said she doesn't know whether she'll be there when her wee boy Jonah goes to primary school, but she didn't expect to be there when he goes to secondary school. Theo was honest, but she was also determined, like many others, in fighting for change. Research investment is the top of her list because, as we've heard from a number of members, just 1% of the national spend on cancer research has been allocated to brain tumours since records began in 2002, despite the fact, as Beatrice Wishart and Faisal Childrey both said, one in three of us will know someone diagnosed with a brain tumour. When we heard from Professor Steve Pollard from the University of Edinburgh and Dr Joanna Birch from the University of Glasgow at the parliamentary reception, they talked about the groundbreaking research taking place here in Scotland. But the challenges of brain cancer means, in Professor Pollard's words, the fundamental science has not progressed to novel therapies. Only by growing the investment in that work will we get the innovation in clinical trials that will lead to the new knowledge, the new techniques, the new therapeutics, and ultimately the improved outcomes for patients that we all desperately want to see. The need for specialist clinical training is also essential. We can see the importance of this in Theo's experience. As Faisal Childrey said, Theo saw multiple doctors about her symptoms, but none of them knew what was wrong. It wasn't until she went to A&E at the Edinburgh Royal Infirmary and had a CT scan that her brain tumour was confirmed. So the need for change, championed by Theo and others, is clear. Survival rates remain far too low and have changed little in over a generation. And brain tumours sadly kill more children and adults under the age of 40 than any other cancer. I'm sure the Minister in her closing remarks will mention the Scottish Government's 10-year cancer strategy. This is a welcome step, particularly the greater emphasis on less survivable cancers, including brain tumours. However, publishing a strategy is one thing, but as Jackie Bailey highlighted, delivering it is another. Alexander Stewart mentioned a similar debate that he held here just over 6 years ago. I remember speaking in that debate. The issues raised then, however, are very similar to the ones that I've heard raised this evening. Stagnant survival rates, inadequate funding, the need for clinical specialists, and the need for more training. During that debate, practically every member shared heartbreaking stories of people who had suffered from brain tumours, and in summing up, the Minister at the time said that what united all the stories was, and I quote, the need to do more and to redouble our efforts. If we're being honest, Presiding Officer, since then, we haven't seen the pace or scale of change required. I'm looking forward to working with Beatrice Wishart and others in establishing the new cross-party group on brain tumours to give a regular forum to these issues. And I hope this time is different and more will flow from this debate. We owe that to Theo and so many others, as we've heard this evening, like her, who have turned their experiences into a positive fight for change.
Thank you, Mr Smith. And I call Finlay Carson to be followed by Carol Mochan. Mr Carson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I also take the opportunity to thank Faisal Childrey for bringing this parliamentary motion to the Chamber today and pay tribute and respect to all those battling brain tumours and those supporting those patients. I've, as Colin said, I've also recently had the privilege to meet and chat to Theo Burrell. a young mum who sadly has an incurable brain tumour. I met her at the Cancer CPG and a couple of weeks ago at the brain tumour event. And can I say that nothing could have prepared me for the talk given by Theo the first time I listened to her, and it was equally as impactful on the second occasion. Theo speaks with enormous courage and openness about her daily battles, not knowing what each day will bring and how many days she may have left. As a father of two young children, I can honestly can't begin to appreciate or understand what Theo and her family are going through, but to share her story in such candid fashion in order to raise awareness of brain tumours is truly remarkable. Listening last week to Theo at the event was one of my constituents, Jill Rennie, and her daughter, whose husband David sadly passed away at home in November. David was a remarkable fella who, in my early days of diversifying for my farming business, provided my brother and I with a huge amount of support through his work with Galloway Ground Base. Indeed, he helped many, many start-up businesses in Galloway. He was also an enthusiastic volunteer in his local community around Gatehouse the Fleet. David had been retired for only a year and was fit and healthy. He was active with a real hands-on volunteer playing a big part in his life. In May 2022, he felt fatigued and complained of having a bit of a headache. When this persisted into the following day, he became confused. Jill, his wife, phoned 101 and she was advised to take him to A&E in Dumfries. After waiting for 4 hours, the on-call doctor decided David had a virus, and he was sent home and advised to take fluids and paracetamol. Jill had hoped, given the unusual symptoms, they would send him for a scan, but being a Saturday, there was limited service. Next day, he slept for most of the day, something that was totally out of character. And when David sat down to his evening meal, he'd lost the power of his left hand. His wife called 999 and was taken to Dumfries and Galloway Royal Infirmary, where he was admitted. On the Monday morning, he was taken for a scan that showed a mass on his brain, a suspected grade 4 cancer. Several days later, on the 1st of June, a day Jill will never forget, the multidisciplinary team delivered its shocking and life-changing prognosis. 3 months left without surgery, 12 to 18 with surgery and radiotherapy. Well, 3 weeks later, David was booked in for a brain surgery in Edinburgh and began radiotherapy 6 weeks later in Edinburgh. Fortunately, they were able to stay with family because there was no help towards the cost of accommodation or travel from Galloway. David had 3 monthly scans and appointments with an oncology consultant in Edinburgh, along with weekly blood tests carried out by a practice nurse. He also had to have regular reviews regarding his medication, particularly steroids, that had to be adjusted depending on his symptoms. As the months drifted on, David continued to feel fatigued and was unable to return to his volunteering, although he did still engage with his friends and people in Gatehouse. Initially, the scan showed no regrowth, but the tumour showed up again in July 2023. Chemotherapy was the only option, but sadly, it was not successful. The Rennie family cared for him until the end of life, and they cared for him because there was little support other than the family available. David did have palliative care for the district nurse, who, along with amazing local GP and surgery staff, but worryingly, maybe because of the rural location, there was minimal input from cancer in Macmillan Cancer Relief, and only 2 nights respite care from Marie Curie, which is disappointing, and it did lead to complications. David spent most of his time at home, where he received excellent personal-centred care. But Jill says she's witnessed and experienced a huge range in the standard of care from health professionals during David's illness. She, like many of us here, feel that unpaid family carers are totally undervalued, and we know that caring for loved ones also can take a toll on the carers themselves. It's simply not right that the quality of care you receive varies so widely, and families are left with uncertainty. And this is particularly difficult with brain tumours, when every day can bring different challenges. We need to see change in the care of our brain tumour patients. But, Presiding Officer, brain tumours survival statistics we've heard have changed little in more than a generation. It's why we need to take greater action in the near future. The fact that just 1% of the national spend in cancer research has been allocated to brain tumours since records began more than 2 decades ago is both disturbing and regrettable. It's little wonder that brain tumour research is now calling for the Scottish Government to declare brain tumour a clinical priority, and that's something I know everyone in this chamber fully supports. Only by investing in more clinical trials will we ever stand the chance of learning more about this devastating disease, allowing us to come up with new techniques, new therapeutics, improving operations and better outcomes for patients. Presiding officer.
Thank you, Mr Carson. Due to the number of members who still wish to speak in this debate, I am minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 8.14.3 to extend the debate by up to 30 minutes. I now invite Faisal Chowdhury to move a motion without notice.
Moved.
Thank you, Mr Chowdhury. Do members agree to extend the debate this evening? That is agreed. I now call Carol Mawkin to be followed by Rachel Hamilton. Ms Mawkin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I also thank my colleague Faisal Chowdhury for bringing this motion to Parliament, raising awareness of Brain Tumour Awareness Month. And can I say, after having met with Theo and Thomas from Brain Tumour Research earlier in this parliamentary session, I'm pleased to see the increased awareness of brain tumour across the Parliament in recent weeks, with questions and roundtables, and of course the developing CPG. This is all very welcome. But of course it must be with purpose and move the dial forward on the results that we need. It's my understanding and key to this is that we must progress the important area of research. Can I thank the members across the parties for delivering such emotive and powerful speeches, personal speeches, during the debate. The number of members in the debate this evening show that this is a very important discussion and it must be something we work on cross-party basis to ensure that we can see improvements in the statistics we have heard about tonight. It is welcome that we have time in the chamber to discuss the impact of this disease and the importance of research into brain tumours in Scotland and of course across the United Kingdom. We know from the motion and members' contributions tonight that this condition has impact right across Scotland. One in three people know someone affected by this devastating condition. We know that survival rates remain low and that devastatingly, unlike other cancers, this has not changed in over a generation. And we know that brain tumours remain the largest cancer killer of those under 40. So this is why it is so important that we do take time in the Scottish Parliament to discuss this. This is why I do support the calls and the recommendations for the Scottish Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care to commit to working with the devolved nations on developing a national brain tumour strategy that addresses the barriers across the whole brain tumour pathways we've heard. This includes diagnosis, care, treatment, as well as that important element of research. I want to focus my remarks tonight on research, and others have done a lot of the work before me, but it has come to the attention, as we can see, of many members across the Scottish Parliament recently, that research in Scotland needs commitment from the Scottish Government. We have amongst the best researchers in the world, and we have participated in some of the most amazing studies and discoveries from across the world. However, we are at a critical point, and some have described it as a crisis point. We know for brain tumour that research into brain tumours is chronically underfunded and under-resourced. Only 3.2% of the overall £700 million investment in UK cancer research funding in 1920 was spent on brain tumours. Now, of course, we know that funding is not the only barrier, and we had a lot of researchers in the Parliament recently. But for brain tumour, we are told from the charities, the brain tumour charities, that current government funding that has been allocated is not being adequately spent on that high quality research that we need. There are also significant delays in translating laboratory research to clinical trials and even further delays from clinical trials to medically regulated approval. And this means that brain tumour patients are missing out on promising new treatments. We must see research into brain tumours recognised as a clinical priority alongside a strategic plan for adequately resourcing and funding so that we can make the discoveries that we need to make in that clinical research. Access to new and better treatments will only come if we harness the Scottish research potential and work as we do so well with our neighbours across the UK. If we want to see changes in the statistics mentioned at the beginning of my contribution and the contribution of other members, we have to see commitment from government and we have to see strong leadership from the Scottish Government in this area. And I would be grateful if the Minister would outline in her closing remarks her plans for funding and maximising that great potential that we have in Scotland for research so that we can see the dial shift on brain tumour research. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Mockin. And I call Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Thank you to Faisal Chowdhury and thank you to Beatrice Wishart. And I'm sorry that I wasn't able to make the event and wear a hat alongside everybody else, but I fully support her wish to bring along a cross-party group on the subject. I think we're all here because the statistics have demonstrated that we all know somebody who has had a brain tumour or will ultimately end up being diagnosed with a brain tumour, and it very much brings it into stark reality when that does happen. And I attended an event with a brain tumour charity on the 7th of March here in the Scottish Parliament, and I invited some constituents who sadly had lost a family member, Tilda Jeffrey, as she was fondly known. And they also have a connection to Selkirk Distillery, and Selkirk Distillery decided to start a gin called Tilda's Tipple, and they donate to the brain tumour charity, and £5 from each bottle goes to the charity. And I think that is highly commendable, and they've done a huge amount of fundraising activities on behalf of the brain tumour charity. And I just want to also commend the charity itself for the briefing that they provided, because it is very clear that the brain tumour diagnosis and those people who have had a diagnosis just seem to be treated differently to other people who have cancers, just different cancers. So for all the reasons that people have made today, the only point that I would make that stands out to me is that when speaking to the charity, one of the areas that they talked about was a new liquid biopsy as a diagnosis tool, which is being developed in Glasgow. And I'm not saying the name of it, Presiding Officer, because I can't pronounce it, and because the first two letters are D and X. But I just want to ask how the Minister and how the Scottish Government will help improve the referral pathway for when this liquid biopsy for diagnosis becomes available. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Hamilton. And I now call on the Minister to respond to the debate. Minister Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I too would like to thank Faisal Chowdhury for bringing this motion to the Chamber today. And I want to praise everyone, all of us who joined in the Wear a Hat Day events on the 14th of March and showed their support to Brain Tumour Awareness Month. Thank you especially to Beatrice Wishart, who sponsored the reception and shared her family's experience. I too was very moved, as Colin Smith and Finlay Carson both mentioned Theo Burrell's contribution. To say that you would have heard a pin drop, I don't think is underestimating the power of her story and contribution to that event. I'd also like to welcome, Thomas Brayford and Nadia to the Chamber, and also Fraser McAllister's parents. Thank you for joining us tonight. And Jackson Carlow, when I see your post, I will repost it. I think it's really important that we all come together and share these stories, because as Jackson Carlow said, it is the power of reaching out that helps us make decisions, helps us come together. And I think, as I said in the Chamber earlier today, we have that privilege and responsibility to be able to do that in a number of walks of life. So I look forward to hearing how the CPG on brain tumours goes together through the procedures, and very happy to come along to that when it's been established. As I did last year, I will highlight a charity that is close to my heart, Callum's Cabin, based in my constituency on the Isle of Bute. The charity is named after Callum Spears, who passed away from an inoperable brain tumour 17 years ago. As Alexander Stewart said, people show phenomenal courage and resilience, and that's exactly what Callum's parents and twin sister did. They turned their heartbreak into something inspirational, and the charity they established now supports children who are undergoing cancer treatment and their families. Callum's Cabin provides holiday homes in three beautiful locations where families can spend quality time together and make lasting memories, and nine flats in Glasgow where families can stay while their child is receiving cancer treatment. Also, on my home island of Islay, there's Julie and Maggie, and on this weekend I'll be attending a coffee morning that Maggie is holding in support of brain tumours. I'm sure you're all aware of the Scottish Government's ambitious 10-year cancer strategy for Scotland and three-year action plan published in June last year. Over the next 10 years, our strategic aim is to improve cancer survival and provide excellent, equitably accessible care. The strategy and plan take a comprehensive approach to improving cancer care and survival, from prevention and diagnosis through to treatment and post-treatment care. We continue to focus on those cancers which have the poorest survival, including brain tumours. As everyone has mentioned, diagnosing brain cancer can be challenging, as symptoms are wide-ranging and can often be vague. I think it's important that people in this debate reiterated the different symptoms. We recognise how important it is to raise awareness of possible symptoms, and our Get Checked Early website has content on brain cancer to highlight symptoms and advises when to seek professional advice. We ran our well-received public awareness campaign, Be the Early Bird, in March and September last year with the aim of reducing the fear of cancer and empowering those with possible symptoms to act early. As Alexander Stewart said, maintaining awareness is shining a light. And I'm pleased to say that that's exactly what will be happening with St Andrew's House on Thursday in pink and yellow to recognise Wear a Hat Day in 2024. As Faisal Chowdhury said, we know that the earlier cancer is diagnosed, the easier it is to treat, which is why we continue to invest in our Detect Cancer Early programme. And this programme takes a whole systems approach to early detection, encompassing public awareness, screening, primary care, diagnostics and data. We also know survival rates in some cancers have improved at much slower rates than others, and that's why the strategy includes a new, earlier and faster diagnosis vision, reflecting Scotland's desire to diagnose cancer as early as possible when the chance of survival and even cure is higher. Whilst our vision focuses on reducing later stage disease, it acknowledges that all cancers, such as brain tumours, can be conventionally staged. Additional measures will be considered to monitor progress and improvement in these areas, including diagnosis via emergency presentations. Kenneth Gibson correctly highlighted the recent success with the development of our rapid cancer diagnostic services. These services are a useful addition in diagnosing cancer in Scotland, providing primary care with access to new fast-track diagnostic pathway for patients with non-specific symptoms suspicious of cancer. As Kenneth Gibson said, we've now set up five in Ayrshire and Ireland, and Fries and Galloway, Fife, Lanarkshire and the Borders. The University of Strathclyde's evaluation report assessing the first 2 years of the services was published last month and shows that the services are achieving precisely what they set out to do. Jackie Bailey, Carol Mochan and others all correctly noted that research is essential if we are to continue to develop new and effective approaches to the diagnosis and treatment of brain tumours. The Scottish Government provides a range of funding to Scottish Health Boards to enable them to conduct high-quality clinical research, including cancer research. This funding includes support for the Cancer Research Network, which operates across Scotland to increase support and sustain clinical trial activity in cancer care. We also provide fellowship funding through the Career Researcher Fellowship Scheme. Several clinical oncologists are supported to conduct critical cancer research within the NHS. I'm just winding up, Jackie Bailey, sorry. Are supported to conduct critical cancer research with the NHS. One such fellowship is centred on researching novel therapies for brain tumours. We have recently established a collaboration with Tessa Jowell Brain Cancer Mission to fund neurology fellowships in Scotland. The aim is to train clinicians to appreciate the breadth of comprehensive brain tumour management and equip them with research skills to lead high-impact practice-changing clinical trials of the future. Presiding Officer, in closing, I'd like to reiterate to members and those watching of the Scottish Government's continuing commitment to improving survival rates for children, young people and adults diagnosed with brain tumours. It is by working together and collaborating that we will achieve this. I'd like to thank all of those who gave their boundless energy towards raising awareness and for the work we know must continue to be done through research, earlier diagnosis and safe and timely treatment. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate and I close this meeting.